WMI, and a big supporter of the Women in Cinema Collective, WCC. Both of these organizations are co-hosting today's event. The Network of Women in Media India, NWMI, is celebrating its 20th anniversary. That's a big, big milestone for us. And this is day two. We opened yesterday with eminent Nobel Prize winner Esther Duflo giving the keynote address. I welcome all our panelists today, the moderator, all of you in the audience, and above all, my fellow host, Beena Paul, the artistic director of the International Film Festival of Kerala and founder member of the Women in Cinema Collective, WCC. The IFFK made big history at its inaugural last night as Beena Paul, the Kerala State Chalachitra Academy Chairman Ranjit, Culture Chairman Shaji Cherian, and IFFK team invited the gorgeous actress Bhavna Menon, who has acted in over 80 films, to light the inaugural lamp. Beena Paul warmly embraced her on stage, and Mr. Shaji Cherian called her a role model for Kerala. Bhavna recently opened up as survivor in the rape case of 2017, where actor Dilip, who has been charged with criminal conspiracy, was arrested and held in custody for 3 months before being released on bail. The case is sub judice. The IFFK has sent out a very powerful signal, and NWMI and WCC heartily welcomes this, with the WCC has done a lot of very, very hard work to achieve where we have arrived tonight. I'd like to introduce the NWMI. The Network of Women in Media India turned 20 in January 2022. We are celebrating this milestone anniversary in March, perforce online, thanks to Omicron. The NWMI is a voluntary, informal, non-hierarchical, participatory collective that has no institutional affiliation, structure, infrastructure, office bearers, or paid staff. It emerged gradually through a slow and participatory bottom-up process that built upon earlier initiative by media women in different parts of India. The network, which has grown into a vibrant forum for women in media professions over the last two decades, aims to fulfill multiple objectives, both professional and societal, at the national as well as local levels. Apart from its obvious function as a forum for addressing issues relating to the media as a workplace, the network facilitates career advancement through the sharing of valuable information, contacts, tips and leads, the exchange of ideas and opinions, as well as mentoring. In a competitive and increasingly cutthroat professional world, it offers solidarity and support, recognizing achievements of fellow members, empathizing with those undergoing difficult experiences, and helping them overcome obstacles of various kinds. The NWMI has taken strong public positions on journalist rights and media ethics while standing alongside women journalists in various kinds of struggles for gender equality, safety, and justice at both individual and community levels. It strives to uphold media standards and ethics and to promote gender equality within the media as well as in society. Our current membership comprises over 650 media women based in almost all Indian states, working in print, digital, and audiovisual media in multiple languages. Members are connected virtually through an email listserv, as well as via social media groups, but also meet in person during periodic national meetings in various venues across the country. Local networks in several cities also organize get-togethers and events from time to time. I would now like to invite Beena Paul to take over. As I mentioned, she's artistic director of the International Film Festival of Kerala, a veteran editor and a founder member of the Women in Cinema Collective, WCC, that has been doing pioneering work for women in film in India, especially to make the film industry a safe space for women, but also for equal opportunity and respect. If history was made last night, it was largely because of their trailblazing, inspiring work in India on the ground. A lot of their members have been hounded and trolled, but they have courageously refused to back down. And last night was an indicator of their power, of their confidence, of self-respect and sisterhood. The subject of today's discussion is Half the Picture, Why Women Need to Tell Stories and Be in Them. Our eminent speakers are Anjali Menon, producer, director, writer, Reema Kalingal, producer, actor, Dipti Gupta, director and cinematographer, Shazia Iqbal, director, production designer, Sunita Tati, producer, and Jenny Dolly, assistant editor. The moderator is Anna M.M. Vettikad, journalist and author. The IFFK has even selected more films made by women in its international section than by men. So it's actually making history twice over. I'd like to thank Amu Joseph for assisting me a lot with this introduction. And I invite Beena Paul to introduce the panel. And yes, long live the sisterhood and the brotherhood. Beena Paul.
Hi. Hi, everybody. It's really a pleasure to be here. Thanks, Meenakshi, for that grand introduction. To talk about WCC is very emotional, the Women in Cinema Collective, especially after yesterday, as Meenakshi said, when for us it was a kind of fruitation or a fractation of 3-4 years of great struggle. Actually, it's really interesting when the horrible incident where one of our colleagues was assaulted happened. At that point, I think at that moment of pain, when we all came together, we never thought that it would reach us here today, which is a body of women working together in an organized manner, advocating for an equal space. This was very unheard of in not only in Malayalam cinema, but I think in Indian cinema on the whole. We, in fact, preempted the Me Too movement, because this happened even before the Me Too movement happened in the West. It's not been an easy journey. We started off, we look at ourselves as an advocacy group, basically. We're watchdogs in this industry. You spoke about yesterday, Bhavna coming on stage at the IFFK, but far more important, or as important, let's say, has been a landmark judgment that we got through the Kerala High Court, which happened. Had moved a PIL seeking for the setting up of ICs in the film industry. The judgment has been very landmark because it not only says that ICs need to be set up, but the fact that the dignity of the worker, of the woman worker, has to be protected. The fact that this is a workspace, as temporary or not as it might be. So this has been really, for us, a very, very, very positive step, and for us, a great victory. But to, while celebrating, we also know that it's a struggle. We got to see all this happen. And apart from being, looking at ourselves as women in, advocating, we also realize that unless we tell our stories and unless there is a presence of women in the industry, this is still half the picture. So I think that leads us on to why it is so important. It is really so important that there are more women who enter. And I think WCC is trying to say, look, come here. It's safe, it's wonderful, it's a lovely profession, and let's all enjoy it together. So we'd like to see the other half of the picture come out, no longer as the other half, but as a part of the picture. Thank you for having me. I'm sorry, I'm right in the middle of the festival, but it's so wonderful to see Jenny, Shazia, Kuti Revati, and of course, Reema and Anjali here. Sunita, who was with us at the conference. So I'll sign off here and hand over to Anna, who's now going to take it forward. Thank you so much. Thank you, NWMI. You are our role models. Thank you.
Okay, so it's my turn to take over. Thank you so much, Beena and Meenakshi, for having done this. And it's very kind of you, Beena, to have called us your role models, because the truth is that, I mean, we find it very humbling at the Network of Women in Media India that you consider us role models, because we take a great deal of inspiration from you. Now, the subject of today is Half the Picture, why women need to tell stories and be in them. And in case viewers are wondering why, what the connection is between what has been discussed so far, which is WCC and the important Kerala High Court judgment this week, and what happened with Bhavna being on stage at IFK yesterday, with the subject of today's discussion, the answer is that everything matters. Representation on screen, representation behind the camera, and also the safety that women feel while they enter the film industry. It governs the decisions that young women make about whether or not they should enter the profession in a society where there is a lot of pressure on women and they don't have the same freedom as men do to take career decisions. The fact that the Kerala High Court has come out with this judgment is hugely, hugely, like a big, it bolsters the women's rights movement across the country. But we're going to be talking about multiple factors that determine the representation of women behind the scenes and before the camera on screen in Indian cinema. Before I ask questions, I will be going one by one to each panelist and asking for their introductory remarks, asking for your interpretation of the theme of the day. And I'm going to be beginning, well, I'm doing this in alphabetical order, so I'm going to begin with Anjali Menon. Anjali, you're an award-winning writer, director, producer. People know you very well. They know your work, and your work, whether it's Bangalore Days or Kure or the film you wrote, Ustad Hotel, has busted the myth that for some reason persists that films made by women or films with strong women characters don't make big money, which is completely true. We know that, and yet we are consistently told that. You are also, of course, a founder member of the Women in Cinema Collective. And I'd like to start with you, ask you for your interpretation of our theme today.
Thank you, Anna. Thank you very much. It's not always easy being the first speaker. So I'm just going to touch upon the subject. I'm very glad to be here among all these powerhouses. You know, each person, each face I see here, they've all, you know, broken the mold, you know, come across, emerged as very strong voices. So it is very, very much of an honor to be here. Also to have, you know, Meenakshi and Beena speak so well about everything that is happening around us. It just sort of reinforces the faith that we have, that there are still spaces where we can speak and be heard, and that things are somewhere making a difference. So yes, NWMI is definitely an inspiration. You're amazed that you guys are celebrating 20 years, because in just 4 or 5 years, you know, it's been quite something for us. And wow, hats off to you for that. Just to come back to our theme today, when we talk about half a picture, I am just reminded of two things. One is that when I was trying to get into films, I remember being asked at home that, you know, you really want to work in Malayalam cinema? Are you sure? I mean, who are the women who work behind the scenes? And I didn't know anyone. And the only name I knew, I kept saying it again and again, and it was Beena Paul Venugopal, that there's this one woman, you know, I know that there's one person like that. And she has, I think, single-handedly inspired a generation of us. And it's wonderful that from that one inspiration, so many of us have come forth. And I think people have more precedence. And this is exactly what it is when you come to speak about what you just said, about people having confidence in directors who are not men, you know, whether they can make money at the box office. Because at the end of the day, that seems to be that one defining factor when gender disappears. You know, money obviously has no gender. So when the box office rings, everybody's willing to listen, you know, irrespective of what the gender of the maker is. I've discovered that firsthand, because till the point that I was following my artistic vision only and not thinking about the audience or bums on seats, I found I was being dealt with in a very different way. I was constantly told that my career was optional, and very easily people would say, maybe you should do something else. They would ask you, okay, what is your other career? You know, they would constantly deal with you as if you're film career was more of a hobby, or it was something that you were doing just, you know, just for a breath of fresh air. It's when your work starts making money that people here actually sit up and take notice. I've found that should not actually make that much of a difference as long as your work is good. But for some reason, it is entirely skewed in that factor. And in that making money spin, a lot of times the content is what really gets compromised. So do I want to compromise on my content just to have acceptance in this industry? No. Do I want to use the formula that exists within the industry or the tropes which exist within there to throw up something fresh? Why not? Do I want to use the vehicles that the industry is already riding in to try and throw in my perspectives of what is a more gender balanced world? Of course, I'd love to do that. So that's been my personal journey. If you ask me, the whole thing about making films which are women centric, putting up narratives which focus entirely on women. I have not done so much of that in my work, but what I have tried is to try and portray a world which is more gender balanced, because that is what I would like to see. Of course, there are a trillion stories that haven't been told, because the dominant narrative here, whether the films are made by men or women, has definitely been male. You know, when Laura Mulvey talks about the male gaze, it's not just the male gaze anymore. It's become the dominant gaze. And a lot of women I know as well have adopted that gaze. So I think, be it leadership, be it how we make our film, be it how we write our characters, be it the basic messaging that every frame is putting out there, I think just an awareness and consciousness about wanting a gender balance within those is what will very gently shift that gaze. And the more we make of content which is gender balanced, I think that is when we'll get to see the true picture emerge. In my limited work, I've just tried to create characters of different genders who are more real, who are fallible, who are flawed, who are heroes, all of it, irrespective of their gender. I love showing men who are, not monoliths. I like showing people who are layered and who are vulnerable and who are just people, and their mental, emotional, physical psyche is not because of the gender that they were born with or they've chosen to adopt. I think it's important to show different people of different, milieu, of different cultures, showing up in their authenticity rather than just because they are of a particular gender to portray them in a certain way. Within this, there is so much that has been left unexplored when you talk about characters who are women. And that is simply because the people who have been making film for the longest time just lack the awareness. They're so clued out of the whole experience that is outside of the male that they really do not know what our perspective could be. And just putting that perspective across is actually wonderful for the audience because it's so fresh even now. I'm often surprised when people say, hey, we didn't know about that. And you wonder, half of us are women here, right? How is it that you've missed out on that? So I recently did a film where I have some characters were pregnant. And it was amazing to watch the actors shed a certain body language that they had adopted. They were actors in front of a camera, and there is a body language one tends to adopt when you are aware of where the camera is and everything. And it was wonderful to see these people just completely shed that and be themselves or be the character rather. And for me, that was a real learning experience because I saw something emerge which I had not anticipated. And what that spoke to me was that there is so much that we adopt and we adapt to what is expected of us. That when you have the liberty to let go, that flows so naturally. It's just waiting for that little crack, for that light to flow in. And the more of those cracks we have in our work, I think that is what will really shift the gaze of the audience, the gaze of the makers, and the gaze of the people within the screen to have more powerful, authentic performances and content emerge. This is my sort of short take on what our subject is today. Very happy to sort of discuss at length, as your questions come up. Thank you.
Thank you so much for that wonderful, for those wonderful comments, Anjali. I'm going to now turn to Deepthi Gupta for your introductory remarks. And Deepthi, when we talk about women behind the scenes in cinema, you very literally are behind the scenes, behind the camera, and you probably have a very unique understanding, therefore, of what actually this male gaze means. Because in a very literal level, not at a figurative level, but you are also straddling different areas of filmmaking, because you're a cinematographer, you've shot several documentaries, you've shot feature films ranging from Honeymoon Travels Private Limited to The Fakir of Venice, and you have also made your own, you're a director, you've made your own feature film, and like us at the Network of Women in Media India, and like the Women in Cinema Collective, clearly you understand the power of the collective, because you're a founder member of the Indian Women's Cinematographers Collective. So would you tell us how you interpret Half the Picture?
Thank you, Anna. Thanks to NWNMI. So many of you are like icons to so many women out there. It's incredible to be even in a virtual room with all of you. Listening to you, Anjali, so many thoughts were coming to my mind. But yeah, just to introduce myself, I went to FTII to study cinematography. And when I went there in 1995, there weren't any predecessors, at least within FTII, and it took me years to even hear about Vijayalakshmi, who had turned producer around that time. And it was like every day having to answer a question about why this, why are you choosing this? But when I came to FTII, I had absolutely no idea that there are no women behind the camera. It didn't strike me at all till I landed on campus and realized this is a strange thing you're picking up. And it took years and years to understand that bafflement of people. It took coming out of FTII after having done very well within campus to again walk into an industry where you again have to prove once again, after having proven something as a student, that you can do your job well, you know, all over again. And very often there would be, I realized that very often a very strange thing happened in the industry. It's like there was a pressure of keeping your politics to yourself if you want to be in the mainstream, if you're a young person, and it left me uncomfortable. And at the same time, I was discovering that the language of the lens was a very male language. All through the history of cinema, women were depicted as the camera going just that little bit higher when it comes to a close-up, or just that little extra diffusion, or, you know, things like that. And to grow up in an industry where if you want to tell a story of a woman who may not be beautiful, but you have to cast a good-looking woman for it. These are like very obvious, well-known tropes for all of us. So in the first 20 years, when I realized that to me, my gender is not defining as a cinematographer, but as a person, of course it is, as my politics, of course it is. But as a cinematographer, does it have to come through in every work that I do? Probably not. You know, maybe I'll shoot a Sufi music video like Bulla. It doesn't have anything to do with my gender. It has to do with my philosophy or my spirituality. Or I might shoot a commercial for a car. It has nothing to do with my gender. But to people who saw me, that's the first thing they saw about me. It was like I'm wearing headlights of, you know, female, female, female. And it took a very long time for me to understand, am I going to fight against it? Am I going to get depressed by it? Or am I going to say, this is how it is. I have a weapon, that's a lens. Am I going to just use it to tell other people's stories and other people's narratives? Or am I going to say, I have more of an opportunity and more of a responsibility as a woman behind the camera to take charge of my own story and find different ways to tell it? And it took years of shooting films and many other things and percolating one's own politics and vision to understand that it's like one can actually pick up any story and find your own politics in it. It's as if every film that one makes can be about yourself in a strange way. So in my first documentary, I found that my protagonist, who's a very, you know, this inspiring firebrand singer, I found that her story had shades of many of our stories. It's the same fight you fight. You ask for equality, there's consequences at home, there's consequences in profession. And I found those themes very interesting. And I just find that note holds true for everything, every story that excites me, simply because it's a very closely lived experience of finding your gender being the filter through which people see you. So even if as an artist, you might want to say, some of my work has nothing to do with my gender, but it's just not, it's not possible to deny it in your own work and in your own voice. And by the time we founded IWCC, many of us who were more senior in so-called senior in the field had been around 20 years. There was this one day when Fauzia, me and Priya ended up meeting a journalist for Stroll, Nandini. And that it was this very strange day. We had never talked to each other and compared our stories, our histories. But when we three talked together, probably very, very deeply for the first time, we were completing each other's sentences. We felt like each of our stories was representative of another's. Why our women are not in the rooms where the big films are being, the cinematographers for the big films are being hired. Our names are not on those lists for no obvious reason at all. One thing I started noticing was when you look at women cinematographers, most of them have deep relationships with one, two, or three directors. That's just how it is. So you work, you have a cloud, and you make friends with the silver lining and say, this is how it is. You're going to make the best of those relationships. And, you look at this gender discrimination as something that's like a sieve, like a channi, that only the sensible ones will come to you and ask you to shoot their films. And another thing I realized was many female cinematographers, and this is not true of most men that I know, because I'm a part of many of those communities too, are multitaskers. They are directors and cinematographers, producers and cinematographers. I feel the time is for women to take every single power that they have in their hands to tell their stories, which is why I feel like this is the topic of this forum is really lovely. I'm aware of the works of so many of you, and those themes come up in so many different ways in everyone's work. It's really beautiful.
Thank you so much, Deepthi, for your comments. And I thought it was very important that you pointed out that one of the early things you discovered was that as a woman who is a cinematographer, you're expected to keep your politics to yourself. And I think generally speaking, in many of our professions, this is an expectation of us, which is also the reason why you hear a lot of people ask, why are women so angry? Why are feminists so angry? And you hear that extended, you hear that about all other marginalized communities. Why are Blacks so angry? Why are Dalits so angry? And to me, always the question is actually, why aren't women angrier? Because there is so much to be angry about. But having said that, what is amazing is that we also find joy in life. We also find so much to be happy about and celebrate. And there is pressure yet, despite that, on women to only be making films, if the films are about women, to only be making films about the sadness in our lives. So I'm going to call on Jelly Dolly right now to make her introductory remarks. Jenny, your presence here is really precious to us because, a lot of the time at seminars and panel discussions, people will go to the HODs and speak to them. But before the Lifetime Achievement Award happens, the lifetime must happen, right? And you are someone who has been an assistant director to blockbuster films and with a director that we all admire greatly, Paranjit. But you're also, you've directed a short film yourself, and you are going to be directing your first feature film soon, which, by the way, we are rooting for you. I'm really waiting for it. But from your range of experiences, would you explain to us what you think of half the picture that we see in the film industries?
It's just absolute pleasure to be among all of you. I mean, I have definitely heard of each one of you here today on the panel. And when I got the call from Beena asking me to be a part of the panel. I was like, who else is going to be there? And I was like, why am I part of this panel? You know, I've just been an AD for the last 6 years. But I mean, Beena and I had a small chat, and I thought that it will just be like, I forgot why I was here and I was listening to all of you. But I have been in Tamil industry for 6 years. And I came to cinema only when I was 30. Before that, I had a whole other lifetime of doing other things. You know, I was a journalist, I was a documentary filmmaker, I was teaching, I was working as a legal aid for a community that was fighting a corporation. I had done everything. And when I was, I interviewed Paranjit for the Tamil news channel I was working for. And I quit immediately after that interview, various reasons. And then he and I just thought that, you know, we should explore working together, because we really liked how it was, the interview was and stuff. And so at 30, I'm walking into a film set for the first time in front, like I am like there, you know, working in the field. And I was just, I think half of Kabali, I was just so busy being, just keeping myself out of the frame, you know. It was just, and it was not easy, you know, because you don't mind making mistakes when you're 22, 23. But when you are 30 and you are starting something new, you're like, I want to get it all right, you know, and you don't, you won't, because it's the travel from non-fiction to fiction is just tremendous. You know, the power that fiction gives you. Like I thought that I would never settle for anything more than nonfiction when I was a documentary filmmaker. And then when I entered fiction, I was like, what is this world? You know, what is this power that comes with, you know, telling these stories? You know, this is what is happening, but I have the liberty, I have the power to say it the way it is happening or say it the way I want it to happen. You know, it's a whole new world. And I was just like, why didn't I know about this earlier? I had no idea that this was a possibility, even though names like Kuti Revati or Prema Revati were all like there. You know, we knew that these women were there in the industry, but what were they doing? You know, it was, and for someone who was part of it, I was part of the media already. You know, it should have been easier for me to access this industry. And then after I came to cinema, and I am talking all this here with the absolute awareness of the privilege I have, in terms of, you know, like my socioeconomic background and the fact that I got to work with one of the most sensitive men you can find in the industry at various, I didn't have to, like, I remember for Kabali, he called me and he assigned me the first department and he said, Jenny, you'd be doing costumes. I did not even ask, like, I didn't talk back. I just said, okay, fine. And I came. And then 10 minutes later, he calls me into his room again and he's like, did you just think that I gave you costumes because you're a woman? I said, did you give me the department because I'm a woman? He said, no. Then he's like, no, it's just fine. Then he explained himself to me. And I was like, okay, that's fair enough, you know? And I think it was in the second film, which was again another Rajnikanth film, I think, Kala, I was supposed to be an associate director. But I think the way work happened and all of that, I ended up being the co-director in that. And then in Sarpata, I was again the first AD for Sarpata. But in spite of having the most sensitive human being as your director, it is not easy because he's not the only person you're working with on set. And it's been like challenging because you do something right, you know, like that is one thing, and you do something wrong, there is just like so many pairs of eyes just waiting for you to do something wrong. And then you are like, you know, there is already the pressure of standing on set and working and this, all these judgments that are continuously passed. And you are, I have like, it's not like, you know, like we, the, our policy on what gender is, what sexuality is. And we are not like, I'm not like many of us, not the kind of woman who keep my personal life secret from, you know, like it's all out in the open. And then you are getting heavily judged for whatever you're doing every day. But in spite of all of that, I think what sustained me in cinema, there have been days when I thought I should just quit. You know, nobody should go through this level of struggle to just do good work. I mean, nobody's asking you. I'm not asking you to pay me extra. In fact, you wouldn't pay me extra. It's fine. I'm not asking you for many other things. I'm only asking to be left alone to do what I am extremely good at and what I love, love, love doing, you know, without having to shout louder than you, without having to jump higher than you, without having to, in spite of working longer hours than you, you know, all that you need is not hear the slight comment that gets passed that says, if she says, the director will agree, you know, the how it every time, you know, you have to keep proving that you are not, you don't have to sleep with anybody to get your job done, you know, and especially when you are an AD, it's just like, you know, you don't want to take it to your director, you don't want to take it to anyone, you want to just keep processing it. It's very hard, you know, in spite of all of this, what has kept me in cinema is that this is a phenomenal medium. I think this is just, you know, a whole new world. And I think that nobody should be denied the opportunity to get into a world like this and say the stories that they want to say, especially women and people from all of the oppressed communities. Because even in the last 5-10 years in Tamil cinema, you see how beautifully the texture is changing. You know, people are like suddenly realizing that there are no separate shots for hip, for breasts. You know, it's all changing, and then you still get the same feeling out of watching that. What do you want when you watch a film? You want to cry, you want to get excited, you want to, you know, like, I'm giving you all of that without having to, you know, make myself an object, you know. Why don't you just enjoy it? And I think that's happening, and I hope in the upcoming years it just happens and happens sooner, because I think we've already lost like what 100 years of Indian cinema. We have a lot to catch up on. I think I'll stop here and just hear from the others. Thank you very much for having me. Thanks.
Thank you so much, Jenny. Before I hand the mic to Kuti Revathi, I just want to remind everyone that we are live streaming this panel discussion. And also everyone who's listening, please note that you can put your questions in the Q&A box, and we will be trying our best to direct some of your questions to the panelists. Now, for the moment, I'm going to Kuti Revathi. Thank you so much for being over here. And you know, when Deepti spoke about most cinematographers being multitasking, I thought of the multitasking that you do and the huge complex I have got following your career, because you seem to be doing just, I mean, everything. You are a poet, you're a lyricist, you're a screenwriter, you're a director. And again, you know, exactly in the way that Anjali is, you have defied this stereotype that a serious, sensible, sensitive woman would be not associated with popular cinema, or that serious, sensitive, sensible content will not make for popular cinema. But you're also editing a journal. I mean, you're doing so many things. So I don't even know where you can possibly begin, but Kuti Revathi, would you tell us what your interpretation is of why women need to tell stories and be in them?
Thank you so much, Anna, and Women Cinema Collective. You know, whenever I start talking about Women Cinema Collective, as Anjali said, I become very emotional, because they have contributed such kind of power, you know, that I really need a kind of team in Tamil Nadu, you know, like Women Cinema Collective, because whatever they have achieved so far is beyond our imagination, we should say.
Okay, I think the technical team will try to figure out why we've lost Revathi and get her back into the room. Until that happens, Reema, I'm going to be coming to you. First of all, again, because every woman on the panel has made a reference to the Women in Cinema Collective. And I have to say that at NWMI, we're so proud to be associating with you. You've done seminal work, and we can see the fruits of your labor. It doesn't happen often, but yet in the past 2-3 months, there's just so many new developments that are clearly a result of the hard work that you at WCC have put in. Beyond that, your personal bio, there's just so much you're doing. You're you're a producer in an industry where there are very few producers. You're an actor, you are a dancer, and you are a founder member and a very active founder member of the Women in Cinema Collective. So why do you think that there aren't enough women telling their stories and there aren't enough women in the stories that are being told?
Hello, everybody. Hi. First of all, 20 years network of women in media. Guys, you people are phenomenal. Seriously, today I was chatting with Anna and she was saying, you know, how, I'm really, really, you know, happy to see what happened yesterday at IFFK. And I texted her back, hugs to you, we did it together. And I really, really mean that. You people have been sisters. I have seen how, whenever an issue came up and we wanted to amplify it, how we didn't have to make a call. The calls came in. And seriously, that means so much. Being here on this panel today while you all are celebrating is very, very important. It's very special for me. And half the picture interpreting that whole theme. I actually wanted to tell something that happened with a friend of mine. She works as a journalist and she's a very vocal feminist and she's quite known to put her thoughts out there on social media. And recently, a script writer approached her and he said, I have the script and I would like you to go through it and see if it is politically correct from a feminist point of view. So she said, okay, I'll do that. And how am I going to be named in the credits? So I think, our time's here because our stories, our emotions, our perspectives finally matter. Finally, they don't have a choice but listen. Like Jenny was saying, I think we've lost out on 100 years and we've just got there, where our stories and what we have to show the world suddenly has some kind of a meaning in a capitalist society, finally. But even while we are at it, a lot of female directors still have to find a one male character who can be cast in such a way that this movie has a certain kind of value. We're still somewhere there. But it's time we understand that we live in a culture where we might need to take all the help we have and just go ahead and maybe cast that one guy, it's okay, but tell your stories. Let your main cast have her story and go ahead and do it. That is where I stand today after all this fight that happened in the last 5 to 7 years, where we were singled out. As actors, it is very, very difficult as we don't create, movies. Like, you know, we have to wait for that one director or a producer to give us a call and, you know, cast us in their movies. But a few of y'all mentioned, when you have a very strong political stand, and when you're vocal about it, and when you are not ready to take anything lying down, and if you're one of those persons who's going to raise your voice and call out somebody, you are the troublemaker. You what's fair and what's unfair or what's right, what's not right. None of that matters, because in the kind of world we live in, getting the work done is more important. Like, you know, somehow get the, I mean, it's okay who's hurt in the process. If, you know, somebody's not getting the right kind of payment, if somebody is not getting the right kind of hotel, right kind of workplace to work in, or none of that matters, you know, and when the work's not getting done and you're the person who's raising an issue there, you're always the troublemaker. And you're always singled out, you're cornered, and you know, you're cast out. I'm glad that today we are in a space where, as women, we can take that stand at least. You know, I am quite sure a lot of women who came before me didn't even have this space. I think we are quite a privileged lot to at least be in a space to unlearn that conditioning, to have that privilege and a support system, and to live in a space where I know I'll have at least 10 women around me holding my hand. You know, we might be bickering, fighting over a lot of shit, but at some point I know I have a safety net. I have a group of people who will understand what I'm trying to say, at least. I won't be cast aside. So even these roles, like, you know, like what we're doing today, like, I'll tell you how I connect this. I saw this poster of Michelle Obama, you know, her move, her series coming out, and Viola Davis is acting in it. And I'm like, you know, we need all these brilliant women to be there, for movies to be made on them. Like, you know, we don't even have a space where we can excel, so that, you know, we have all those things reimagined and reinterpreted and shown on screen, on a large screen. Today I was watching how, you know, two of the most important Oscar nominated films was about motherhood. So, you know, and how different and how complex motherhood is, rather than just about you know, the sadness of or the loneliness of being a mother, or the hardships of being a mother. So, you know, so it's so interesting for me as a woman to be where I am today. And I am hoping that in the time that I'm going to be around, that there's something that you know, I can do as a director as well, not just as an actor.
Thank you, Rima, and rooting for you to, you know, make, we are looking out for that first film that says directed by Rima Kalingal. You cannot imagine how wonderful and amazing it is to watch a film which says produced by Rima Kalingal or Anjali Menon, or just any woman. When I watched Jalsa this week, the Hindi film, and it just felt so good that the first name was Vidya Balan. And, you know, I remember a time when, it still happens, but you know, when I used to have to fight in the newsroom when there are two characters, man and woman, equal roles, and it would not matter whether the woman is even a bigger star. Very often, her name would still come second to his in the credits, automatically assumed that you must mention the man first. So all of you are amazingly inspiring women, and we've got Kuti Revathi back. So I'm just going to run to you and Revathi, hoping for your opening comments.
Let me continue, because, you know, I don't want to, I don't want to share my personal experience with the industry, because I still want to hold on to the fight, because it is still, you know, I'm fighting, I'm doing something, I want to make sure the fight is on. That's the only reason. But these days, after I got this, you know, title of the picture, you know, I've been reflecting on this subject, and it goes on. It is growing up inside me, you know, where I'm standing and where every one of us is standing. Actually, what are the disadvantages with men's storytelling? Men's stories generally map the arc of exile from their family or homeland, usually, of losing faith and regaining it, or of being tested for their faith. These are the main subjects of their stories, you know, when we go through men's storytellings. Usually fightings, killings, violence, and vengeance are basic ingredients of men's stories. So the society is very convinced of this theme of violence totally. Rape and sexual violences are considered as the methods to exhibit their violence. That's very much part of the psyche of the men, I believe. Not only as a theme, but also as a solution in their storytellings. Instead, simply the control over a man's belief and, you know, and their belief system is enough to be considered as a problem to them, and the men feel immediately very oppressed and threatened. For them to live is to fight. So it is any man's belief fighting, psychic belief. So the said to be masculine traits are typecast through the history, on screens and, you know, behind the screens, anywhere in writings. So, and men don't develop different qualities in them through the history, as far as we know. Because of men's continuous storytelling, I think somewhere war, fight has become a metaphor in our life, common life, and rape has become a metaphor in our personal life. So our lives are becoming very anxious these days, you know, mentioned here. After all these times of men's storytelling on screen and everywhere, we can still not call it as of the picture because they haven't arrived anywhere, I think, as a creative person. Why the world needs women's stories? Because women are vibrant in communion with nature and universe. Women carry fundamental human learning. Women individuation is very functional. And women bring life into the world. And finally, we won't be blaming anything because we don't have time for that, to blame anyone in this world. We never have done that. I've been listening to women's stories all these times. I've been reading biographies, but they don't want to blame. Somewhere they want to find out, maybe they want to get some insights out of it. Through our storytelling, women should take the chance to lead the humanity out of their destructive patriarchal pattern and belief. Most of these times, women succumb to imposter syndrome. You know, we think whether we are of self worthy of this, we have any self values for connected with what we do. We always, you know, assess our personalities and the work we do. But men really don't have that kind of situations in their life. For feminization of culture to happen, I think women voices matter, women's values matter, and women's stories matter the most. When it comes to India's kind of storytellings, all the social systems are fabricated by the patriarchal norms in the forms of caste majorly and the religion very inherently. The victims are women ultimately. As survivors, I think we have to cast the story nets to abolish all these oppressions. I want to quote here the Laura Mulvey's, you know, quote. In a world ordered by sexual imbalance, pleasure in looking has been split between active male and passive female. This has been exercised on screens very much, in men's films. The determining male gaze projects its fantasy onto female figure, which is styled accordingly. So I want to add to this that women are oppressed accordingly. Between active male and passive female, the oppressions are being exercised, executed, and pictured. When women start to narrate the stories, it will be very affecting and threatening to men. That's why we are not allowed to write. We are not allowed to, you know, whenever we use our creative tools, women are being threatened to the core. In all socially constructed ways, psychologically or financially, and sexually. When I say it affects men economically or financially, it is very obvious that the whole global market of cinema has been built only to the economic benefits of men's stories famous. We don't have the market. Our stories don't have the market, or at least we are not allowed to sell our stories in the market. So we have to really hunt for what kind of characters and stories, characterizations we can bring out with our stories. So when the rationalization, you know, it is also trying to justify the frameworks of patriarchal mindset and social setup. So the persistence occurs, I believe. That's how men are convinced of the fact of normalizing the war, normalizing the violence, normalizing the oppression anywhere in any form. It involves greatly redefining the term, what it means to be a man now, actually. So it has come to our hands, I believe, what it means to be a man finally. And it can be done only through women's storytellings. You cannot practice at home these things because it doesn't have persistence. When it comes to creative works only, you can change the persistence and you can erase it also. We have to teach men about their self-worth in the most unmanly terms. So whenever we try to start telling our stories, we may succumb to habitual anxiety, but at the same time, we feel the complete inner joy that we have been stopping from our childhood. This is the most worthy exercise in any woman's life, I believe. Western women storytellers used to say that storytelling is a healing process for women. But I think it's a defining process, a process of regeneration, a process for reconstitution. As a poet by practice and identity, I strongly recommend the imageries to be reproduced, replaced on screen. That way only we can rewrite the history. And with this, I want to finish my opening remark. And thanks to the panelists and the organizers and listeners. Thanks for inviting me.
Thank you so much, Koti Revati. And now, Shazia Iqbal, I'm coming to you. Again, you know, like we were talking before the panel discussion happened, there are so many people that we see these days. One big change in the film industries when I started covering cinema about 20 years ago and now is that now I see a lot of women on sets. But like it is in my field, journalism, there are a lot of women around, but very few HODs and very few women right at the top, which is why it is interesting to see, however small a number it might be, to see women DOPs. And in your case, you're a production designer. You've worked on shows like Sacred Brains and the anthology Lust Stories, besides other projects. But you clearly also are someone who wants to be directing, because you've debuted with your first short film. And you have also made a feature film, Blood Circle, which was selected for the Film Independence Global Media Makers 2019 Residency Lab. So I'm assuming that we are going to be seeing a lot of you, your work, not just as a production designer, as we have seen already, but also the directed by Shazia Iqbal films. So Shazia, your interpretation of half the picture.
Yeah, thank you, Anna, for the introduction. Just to clarify, Blood Circle is just in the scripting stage. It hasn't been shot yet. But I am developing another feature film, which is supposed to be shot by the end of the year. So that one point. My congratulations to, NWMI for completing the 20 years and for WCC for doing such great work. It feels like there's a support system. So even though we are individually fighting our own battles, we understand that the system, the support system that has started coming up matters a lot. I started as a as an assistant art director 15 years ago in the Hindi film industry, when it was really odd, like there would be five women on the set, including all the departments. So, and in production design, it used to be me. And during setting days, it used to be like 100 male workers and ADs and other assistant art directors and the production designer, and I used to be the only woman. So that was the first time I started realizing that work is gender specific, because I'm raised in a house where when I was 8, my father told me, you don't have to be married. You just have to make something of your life. So I'm raised in a house where, because most of the girls face a lot of gender oppression right from the house level, from their relatives, from extended families. And I fortunately did not see that because my father strongly believed in emancipation of women. So it was really odd for me that on set, when I'm with these men and they would just not look at me, they would not hear me, they would not want to talk to me, like they would see through me. So it was very odd when I started working. And in 3 years' time, I became an HOD. I did my first independent project when I was 24. And the same pattern continued, like my DOP wouldn't look at me, my male DOP wouldn't look at me. Till I would reach a point where I would prove myself with my work. And it was really, it was like a constant fight. And it felt like, okay, if I do one film, I'll be sorted. If I do two films, three films, but the pattern just followed for a long time to a point where this director said that he doesn't want a female production designer because he's doing a big budget film. He was doing a sequel of a film that had become a huge hit that year. And the associate had referred my name to him because he had worked with me. And the director said he doesn't feel comfortable working with a female production designer because there is a lot of set construction. So women are okay with decorating. And, you know, because we've all, the system is so patriarchal that they've designated what women can and cannot do even when they are there inside the system. So there are a lot of women, girls, they were coming in production design. But big set construction period films would go to a man, and while smaller on-set location, dressing up, all of that would go to women. So it was really funny to see that bifurcation, because it's made in the head that what women can do. Basically, film industry is a subset of the society at large, right? And what we have assigned, the roles that we've assigned to women outside, we are making the same bifurcation inside the film industry. So after that experience, I thought, okay, leave this. And like, you know, I want to write and direct my own stuff. And when I wrote the first script and it went to a screen, it was selected for a screenwriter's lab. And in the pitching process, there was a big studio that told me, and I of course wrote a script about a female, with a female protagonist. And the studio person told me, a female director making a film about a female protagonist, I mean, who will give you money? So he told me, you either sell us, and he was very blunt about it, which sort of felt very discomforting, that at least have that thought that, you know, it's, you're openly discriminating against a gender, which is just as much like, you know, women are 50% of the world. So you're openly discriminating against a person, telling them that you give us a script because we are not sure if you can direct it, or you change the female protagonist into a male protagonist. And I told them, no, thank you very much. And that film is still not made. That happened 5 years ago. But it was a learning lesson of how the industry looks at you. Because what is happening here is we are fighting against the entire system. We are fighting against the stigma that, can women do it? Can women direct a film? Can women shoot a film? Can women write a film? So it's become this constant everyday fight that you have to prove them wrong. And I'm not sure men go through this entire process. I mean, I'm sure filmmaking is a tough business, tough work, you know, creative work. It's crazy for everyone. But women have that added disadvantage of proving ourselves because we are born in this gender. And because the work we are doing is supposed to be a man's job, and we are taking their work. And we are saying, hey, listen, it's not man's job. It is irrespective of gender. We can tell a story. Like, storytelling is the oldest form of art. And we've all grown up listening to stories from our nannies and dadis, and not our nanas and dadas. So if women can tell story, that's the basic level of, you know, we can become directors and writers and production designers, DOPs. We can tell our stories. Storytelling is a human thing. So I'm guessing it's time for us to change the status quo and, you know, snatch back the idea that, you know, it's a gender specific thing. And that's why women need to tell more stories and be in them. And most importantly, be in them, because films and media influences culture. Films and media influences society. So if you're keeping half the one important entire gender out of your films, you're saying women are not important. So that's why we need to see more women on women are also, like, I think Anjali mentioned it, that women are also falling in the trap of writing male characters, because ultimately film is, it's a business. It has to make money. And it's an entire system where men cater to, where male characters are written for men. The entire system works like that. So if you write, a female writes a female character, nobody wants to give money. So that's why women, when they get their chance, they write male characters. So somebody funds the film and somebody makes it. So it's a very, I mean, we've just started, I feel. Things have changed in the last 5-7 years, but that's, it's a long road ahead. Because at some point, we have to start making Gully Girl instead of Gully Boy. And then that film earns 200 crores, it will matter. That means, what does 200 crore means? It means people are coming to watch the film. It's not really checking a film's capacity on the money it's making, but it's actually that people are coming to the theaters to watch it, which is what we want. We want a woman protagonist film to make a lot of money. And I hope, all of us here on this panel are able to make that little difference, small difference to that change. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Shazia. You were talking about Gully Girl being made. And I remember, when I watched Boyhood, and to me, the most important part of Boyhood and the most interesting aspect, honestly, was Lorelei Linklater. And I thought, why is it only Boyhood? Why was the film Girlhood, chronicling her entire growing up years, not made? And it seems to be that people aren't even thinking of it. It's not even occurring to them. When you meet producers and directors as journalists, a lot of the time, it's not occurring to them. And if I know, Sumita, that when I have asked producers and directors over the years, why are all your films male dominated and men centric? They say, well, shouldn't I make the films that come naturally to me? And I always tell them, yes, you should. But can you tell me why the stories of only men come naturally to you? Because women are 50% of the population. And again, among the men, it is the upper caste man. It is the man from the religious majority. It is a man from a certain class of society. Sumita, of course, you've seen both sides of the, of filmmaking. You have vast experience across media, firstly. You've set up your own production house. And like other members of our panel, you've just basically made a habit of churning out blockbusters, completely, again, busting the myth that women cannot make big money at the box office. Frankly, even if a film doesn't make big money, sometimes there is the potential for it in the future that needs to be seen. But just this myth, which is then held against women and the scripts that women write, is very damaging to women who want to write about women, and men also who want to write about women. So why do you think that Indian cinema is giving us only half the picture of humanity?
That's a very long question. And thank you, Anna. Thank you very much. And it's so overwhelming to be part of this entire, empowering and absolutely enriching experiences. And I like to congratulate a network of women in media. And on top of it, about a few years back, I met this absolutely powerful center and enriching women, WCC, in 2019, which changed my perspective, coming from the Telugu industry. And when I was invited by Beena to be part of 2019 gathering, I was so happy, because Beena has been this woman who's always on the phone. And that phone call was facilitated by Anjali, who wanted her beta tape of Manjadi Kuru, which I had to steal out of one of the big labs and courier across for the Kerala festival, and that made history. And it's very close to my heart, that entire experience. Hopefully I'll capture that in a story someday. So for me, honestly, the whole journey is very organic. I never thought I would be here. I never thought I would be in these shoes. Somewhere within me, there is always the little girl who was raised in a very small town. And my only escape from everything that was happening around me, which was very overwhelming for me, I was a very sensitive child, was cinema. I used to get to theater and watch something on the big screen and forget everything, that I had to get back to a home where I'll be questioned about my grades, because I was never good at school. all I wanted to be is there on the big screen. And that was a huge distraction for me. And when I wanted to come into cinema also, my first choice was to be in front of the camera because I thought that was the only option I had. And one day my brother asked me a very, very interesting question. He said, Suni, I know you want to be there. You know, we will have our own queries, whether and why and all, like the way Anjali mentioned, coming from a bit of a privileged background. And he said, when the director keeps the camera and then you are about to act and give your shot, do you feel that's what you are inside? Or do you feel the camera need to be on another side, or you can say a better line, or you feel like you have something more to say? And I immediately said, you know, most of the time I just compromise whatever they give, I wear, and whatever they want me to say, I say. And he said, why do you want to do that? Don't you want to be the person who really want to say what you feel rather than listen to the director? And don't you think your point of view matters? Even till today, I'm very grateful for the thought process he brought in me, because I wasn't aware of that I'm allowed to say what I want to say. I wasn't aware that I can actually change the camera, you know, shift the angle and say what I want to say. And that made me go back to film school, get my PG in cinema, and then I came back. But do remember, I came back to the again same field where I wrote a script and I was told by the lead writer and the producer, no, a woman can't slap the hero in the script. You know, no, you need to change your script. We don't make movies like this. Because in my very first film, the woman actually slaps the hero and then the whole love story begins. So I'm like, what am I doing? I mean, I didn't know. I grew up, I became an adult in the US. And I started to sit and kind of rethink what it is, what cinema did to me, being raised in a family which had a strong female-centric upbringing. The conversations is about inspiration and very strong philosophical point of view. And every Friday is about, why did this cinema come? What it is all about? Who's this new hero? Who's this new heroine? So I started to think what cinema did to me. So there were some strong thinking that went into me. When I went to cinema, I always used to cringe because I looked up to my brother, who's the hero in my life, and every hero's sister used to get raped in the 70s, 60s. And I used to cringe in the theater. I used to be like, whenever that scene is about to happen, I used to close my eyes. And I look back at that young girl who was sitting in the theater, and somewhere in me, I always said, I'll never make a cinema like that. I want to sit next to my brother and watch the cinema equally. And I want to sit next to my father where I can come back home and be proud of the girl that I am. I can be the hero's sister. So if you ask me about half the picture, I am greedy. I want to be the full picture. You know, I am sitting here working hard to set up something to be the full picture. And I take films and I change my heroes to heroines only because I want to be the full picture. I am not going to compromise to be the half picture. I believe that we as a country and we as a gender are at a very, very critical time in the history of storytelling. And mind me saying this, human beings remember history only through storytelling. There is nothing else that we remember by. Only stories tell us what is past. And the stories we are going to decide to tell now is going to define our future generations. And we need to be very careful what we say, because there is another young girl sitting in another small town wanting to take our place in the future. And we need to set a very strong foundation that she is the hero of her life and she gets to tell her story. So that's why I'm here, and I am very greedy for the full picture.
Well, I think we're all greedy actually for the full picture, and maybe that's the reason why also patriarchy feels so threatened, because women are demanding that the mic be handed to them, that the camera be handed to them, and that we are allowed to live up to our potential, because there are so many of us who are incredibly talented. There is, by the way, a bunch of questions that are flowing in from the audience, but I'm also greedy for your time. So I have questions too. And Anjali, I'm going to come back to you and ask this question. We're all agreed that there aren't enough roles for women on screen in our films. But there is an automatic assumption some people make that an increase in the number of producers, directors, and writers who are women will automatically increase the number of roles for women on screen. But is that true, or is it a simplistic assumption? Anjali?
I would think that it's not just in the number, the perspective is very important. When Sunita is talking about a kind of cinema that she wants to put out there, there is a thought behind it. There is a philosophy. She's seeking a balance. She's wanting the full picture to portray what she sees as her worldview. If we have more number of producers who are simply going to be chorus girls to the existing narrative, that doesn't change anything. We need people who are gutsy, who can put, you know, their money where their mouth is and actually make a difference. And for that, it's more than about quantity, it's about quality. So I really think the kind of person, and for that matter, it doesn't, even if it is a person of any gender, when they have their thought in the right place, that is what matters. This is my perspective on it. I mean, I don't know if everybody would agree, but I think over quantity, quality matters. But that said, for the whole experience of filmmaking to change, it is very important that more women come behind the scenes. That's very important because we have, you know, forever been the minority. And please do not include people who appear on screen, because there's a lot of privilege with somebody who appears on screen. On screen, a woman who works off screen is very large. The disparity is very large. So much so that even media often is not interested in the women who are behind the screen. You know, when in WCC, when we have cases of survivors, when people want to speak up and journalists call you, you know, I have had to speak to journalists and say, yes, okay, this person will speak to you. She's a technician in this. And they're like, oh, no. Can one of the actors talk to us? You know, so the privilege is hugely different. So I believe the number of women who appear on a film set working behind the screen, each of them is a hero because they have already battled, you know, a lot of social perceptions to choose this field of work. They have already been through, you know, intense journeys to get there. And those are the people who will actually be able to make a difference. So the larger number we have on set, no matter what craft they are, you know, deploying on that set, I think that will change the perception about what a crew is, as that a crew is not a male dominant space, that your gender is not supposed to be foregrounding your work. That, you know, that when a girl comes on your set, I had another member of WCC recently work on one of our sets. And when she came to us and she said, for the first time, I did not have to think about whether I was a woman or a man to be working. You know, I could leave my gender behind and just do my work and focus on that. For me, that's something that speaks about a space which is, you know, equal, that speaks about a place which is professional, where one can actually do one's best without constantly being reminded about your gender and anything. When we are doing our work, we're not thinking that, okay, I'm a woman, how am I going to frame the shot? No, that is me as an individual trying to, you know, speak from a place of creative vision. Of course, we will be mindful about what we say. We will be mindful about, you know, how things are portrayed. That is definitely coming through with it. But to say that, you know, you are a woman director, you're a woman cinematographer, it's almost like you're not supposed to be here. A normal director would be a man. I mean, where is that narrative coming from? So I really think that people who are conscious and sensitive need to come into positions of leadership. That is very important. Be it producer, be it a director, even be it a writer, that's extremely important. But in all other areas, we really need more people who are not there because they belong to any gender. We need definitely more women on our sets. We definitely need that because that will change the whole impression about what a set can be like. I hope I've answered that question.
Yes, and you've in fact answered to a certain extent my next question also. But Deepthi, I was wondering if you would take this. The opposite side of which, the other side is that when a woman is a producer, director, writer, there is this expectation that automatically she will be writing about women. She will be making a film about women. And this is not a burden that is placed only on women. Women from all, people from all marginalized communities face this, the Dalit community, people from religious minorities, people from the LGBT plus community. So is there this added, is there a responsibility if you are a woman who is in a leadership position in cinema? And is there an unfair burden being placed on women in leadership positions in cinema?
I mean, personally, Anna, I don't feel it's an unfair burden or anything like that. But it's a question that has often come up within IWCC, because IWCC is a group of cinematographers. And when it comes to cinematographers, there is no, it's not an expectation for you to politically align with either the subject of the film or, the politics that should in the mainstream reflect in the film is that of the filmmaker, not of the cinematographer. So within IWCC, there are people who believe that my politics is the center of my image making. And there are people who believe that, what does my politics have to do with image making? If I am asked to do an item song, I'm a cinematographer, I'm going to light it well, I'm going to jazz it up, I'm going to take those hot shots, and that's okay. And I do feel that if there are women who want to be part of the mainstream in that way, they're entitled to be. But it's a very personal question for everyone. You know, for me, I know my answer. I know the answer of a few people, but it's different for everyone. There are also women cinematographers who are shooting the most raunchy of item numbers, and their view is, a man's going to shoot it anyway. Who cares? This language is not. I'm not defining this language. This is the market, and the market is asking for this. So what's the problem if I find my place in it? But after almost two decades of working with image making in different kind of genres, what became clear to me personally was I found that also after years of what is called kind of banging your head on the mainstream in some way after doing a few films and then again and again being asked for women's subjects. But not because you'll bring some gravitas to it or depth to it. Sometimes it is that, which is really wonderful. Sometimes the film needs a woman to shoot it, but sometimes it's just some kind of a packaging, you know. And I started feeling like it's just important to not just lend your hand to other people's narratives, but to find the narratives ourselves. And that's often a conversation that happens within IWCC. And a very interesting anecdote comes to my mind. When the Me Too movement was in full swing, I was at that time as now a member of many different cinematography groups. And aside from IWCC, they're 95% are men. And on one of these groups, one of the very senior DPs put up this post post one day saying, look at this actress, look at the clothes she's wearing. And now she's accusing someone in Me Too. And for an entire half an hour, there was no one who objected to that. So I had to fume and then calm down and say, what are we talking about? We are making these images. We are lighting these women this way. We are shooting them this way. We are taking these, this creed of cinematographers are taking these boob shots. We are working in a business that is selling this. And how easy is it for us to say, oh, look at what she is doing, It's a whole system that is asking for women to represent themselves this way because there is, to my shock, there was only two cinematographers on that group who sat up and said something to the effect of, let's not talk about these things on this group, let's just keep it about cinematography. And I thought, what I was saying was, if this is the shit that we are talking about, can we at least look at our own language? Can we at least look at how we are talking about these women that we are shooting? Can we at least, address this? This is the time in history to address our own image making, But no, the group just ended with, yena political baat thoda baar rakho. This is about cinematography. Let's talk about HMI lights and, filters and all that stuff. So I am really, to all of us in IWCC, such a breath of fresh air that we talk about the gays, we talk about how women are represented in films, how they are represented in cinematography, what can we do to change it. And also there's all the time, conversation about what women are going through on set behind the camera. What kind of questions are asked to assistant cinematographers, how they're questioned about knowing their craft. And it's sometimes I find that it's easier to be from a film institute and just shoot into launch into your first film, because the first day you're behind the camera and not in an assistant position, it's a job of responsibility. So you end up answering a lot of questions and things go quiet, but it's so much harder to climb up the ladder. It's so much harder because you don't have the backing of a degree. You don't have the backing of a peer group. I just feel that there's too many questions that come up about how we are representing women and how we are representing ourselves behind the camera. It's very like there's a synergy. It's not often that I've been. It's not rarely that I've been asked by people that I want a cute assistant. Yeah, you know anybody in IWCC? And I'll be like, oh. What is that? So yeah, but I just find that it's very important to keep your questions going, and it's also important to stay in good humor and just,
Anjali raised her hand. I think Anjali wants to add something to what you've said.
I just wanted to say to Deepthi that exactly the same thing happens when it comes to assistant directors. I was so happy to see Jenny Dolly here, because that position is, I think, one of the most difficult positions on the crew, even more than director or anybody. Being an assistant director, staying in that position, working for 6 years, what you've done, God bless. And then arriving at the position of a director, growing through the ranks, I think in our industries is the most difficult thing for a woman. Yeah. So it's hats off to anybody who's managing to do that. Any day it's easier to head to the top position and do it. And I've never assisted, in India, but I really don't know how people are doing it. It's amazing for those who can, and all power to you.
Okay. There are questions flowing in from the audience also, as I said, and I'm going to throw this to the producers on the panel. The back end has passed this on to me, and I'm sorry, I don't know the name of the audience member who's asked this, but the question is, how do you pitch ideas in an industry where the content preferred to be produced or consumed is so masculine, and the feminine idea and the female gaze is always ignored or rejected? Sunita, will you perhaps address that first? And then if the other producers could also take it.
One thing I have to say is that when you are telling the story, be very clear which story you are telling. I strongly believe in not taking the stand of a fight. It's about the story, because story, when it is strong enough, it speaks. It doesn't have a gender. Story doesn't have a gender. A dream doesn't have a gender. A point of view doesn't have a gender. So when I listen to a story, the first thing I check is that, is this humanistic? Does it have the balance it need to have? See, the stories are many. Millions. I mean, I would say all the 8-some billion of us right now growing in number, all of us are stories. And there is no gender to it as such. So my point of view would be, first, be clear what is that your intent want to stay. Like, I see it all the time. Like, people come to me, people tell me, oh, you are a female producer, I have a female story for you. And honestly speaking, I just knock it off. I said, the story is not a gender. First, tell me the human element of your story. Then we will decide what gender it belongs to. Because right now we are all sitting and talking, and the most important common factor for all of us is that we are human first. Somewhere where the masculine started to go forward is because all that they had to go through, they just spread their brick first. We are building on it. What we build is very important for the generations to come. The idea is not to be very careful and say that it's not divide and rule. It's a collective. We all have to come together to tell stories that mean to both the sides. So I always tell the, like when people come to me and say that, oh, we want to narrate this story, we have this script to consider to you, you know, this is very feminine, this is very this. I say that, is it human first? I think that's why we are all here, because we have to tell humanistic story that has a female point of view. If you miss that human appeal, we suddenly again become a different wing altogether. Then I believe in that holistic approach, honestly, more than any other point of view. You know, that then you have a larger scope of audience to tell the story. I mean, all the stories I have done, whether it is my very first film to the film that I'm doing right now, I mean, I took a story and changed it two men to a two female story, because no two heroes wanted to work together. It was so easy for me. I said, okay, if you don't want to do it, let's get two women to do it. And I made them two cops, because none of my heroes wanted to do. They're like, can you give me that interesting character and change more of my screen time? Whereas both the women who are working with me are super excited to be together. You know, both Niveta and Regina said, let's do this, you know, let's just, you know, and they both are there, and it's exciting to work in such company. Now, those are the decisions we need to make. So I think the humanistic approach will actually make us stand apart. And that's why we are the mothers of humanity. You know, we are the people that give birth to the humans. So I think we are here to balance strongly. So we should be very careful, because we have every step we make from here on in the coming decades is going to influence many, many generations to come. So I think between the feminine and the human, we have to have that balance very, very carefully. Yeah.
Okay. So that question was from Ditri Bordoloi. And I want to take this now to you, Jenny, because Sunita was looking at it from the point of view of a producer, but you are going through that whole pitching process that's fresh in your mind right now. So what are the challenges you have faced in the pitching process? Shazia touched upon it during her opening remarks. Could you tell us about your experiences?
Yeah, I just, I mean, we were talking about it, Anna, in the morning. I just feel like when I am, so basically I have, there are a lot of pressures. One, because you're a female filmmaker, and then you are a female filmmaker who has assisted a certain director. Okay. And then it's just like, you know, I was just telling Anna in the morning that the pressure to make the right film is immense, you know. And I was telling her how I almost feel like, you know, like my chastity as a first-time filmmaker who's a woman who comes from a certain, you know, school of filmmaking is put through so much test. It's like I'm taking a virginity test, you know. There is just so much pressure to be right. There is so much pressure to be, you know, like it's almost like, you know, exactly the things that I wanted to avoid in my life, you know, as a married woman, whatever, all those things I wanted to avoid invariably are coming up when I'm going to pitch, you know. So the moment I go, like I contact someone, first they say, do you have any award films? I was like, listen, I'll make a film and I'll ensure that I win awards. I can't have an award film, you know? And then they say, do you have films that have women as the lead? I'm like, yes, but I may not want that to be my first film. I have another story that's like what Sunita was saying. It's a story, you know, it has two people in it, and I can make it as exciting as it can be, because that's how the story is, you know. And then there is another set of people who are like, Jenny, are you sure, you know, like this will be your first film, don't make it for any like a female or a male, you know, large, like big protagonist, say what you want to say. I'm like, what if this is what I want to say? What if I want to make a story that sells? Because that's what I've been seeing. You have made a film that sells. I want to make a film that sells. I want to make sure that I am around in this industry for 10 years, because there's nothing wrong in wanting to be around this industry for 10 years. You have been around here for 50 fucking years. You know, I don't mind being here for 10 years. Don't don't put me through this test. Because every time you sit down to write, you're like, am I doing this right? Am I doing that right? I'm not going to make a misogynist film. There are certain things that I have for myself as principles that I would never go back on. It's not going to be casteist. It's going to be very class sensitive. It's not going to be misogynist. It's not going to be against any sexuality or any oppressed communities across the globe. You know, that's what I want to be sure of. But apart from all of that, if I'm going to tell a clever story that is going to get me a producer, that's going to get me, ensure me a second film. You know, there have been such brilliant female directors in Tamil cinema who I really, really have been inspired by, did not get a chance to make the second film. Why are you asking me to be the ideal person in this when you can be a crook, when you can be all of these things? I don't mind being all of that. I don't want to be pure. In fact, I want to be everything that is against that. You know, I want to be calculative. I want to make sure that I am here because I'm 36 years old. I've worked really hard for 6 years. Nobody gave me anything on a, you know, like silver platter. I want to make a film that is a hit, that is seen by a lot of people, that will just make sure that many, many, many women like me will come into cinema much younger. You know, I feel like I'm so tired of working in 3-4 films. Now, when I want to make my own film, I feel like I don't have as much energy as I would like to have. I think for me right now, I'm very clear. I'm just like, I'm going to make a story that I have fun, you know, making. I don't want to be making a film that, just because it is the right thing to do, you know. I want to make a narrative that everyone has been, I want to make popular films. And then I have films that I want to make without convincing anybody. I have like stories that I don't want to go and pitch to a producer because they're never going to understand, like most producers, maybe will not understand it. I want to be in a position where I can make it on my own without having to explain myself to anyone. The process of explaining yourself to everyone day in and day out on set, everywhere, it's tiring. Half the time, I'm not even tired of working hard. Half the time, I'm just tired of explaining myself to people. Can you ask the artist to come? Why? What do you mean, why? Because they have to come. So I take care of dubbing for my director's films. Can you do this? Why? 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 You know, it's very tiring. So if I'm going to give you some correct answers, and then you're going to let me make my first film, I'm giving you the correct answers. And please let me make my first film. Because then I can ensure that I have second and third films. It is a challenge. It's not easy, you know, to be, I'm saying, without having to play small. I'm also very tired of playing small, playing dumb. You know the answer for the 10th question that is coming, but you have to wait because they need to catch up with you, you know, for 9 questions. And then you're like, you know what, actually speaking, like, right, you were answering it then. And then this whole thing of, I have this way of handling, it's like, as you were saying, they would have never said it. They would never even dream of saying it, you know. But then you're like, as you were saying, and they're like, did I say something so clever? Of course you did, you know. It's just, I'm saying, and also like you were saying, Sunita was saying, let's have fun making films. You know, like I refuse to go to work like I'm going to a war zone. I refuse to do that. I love working. I love being on set. I am the happiest when I'm on a set. I'm the happiest when I'm coordinating. And I'm the happiest when actors, especially female actors, after Sarpatta Paramrai, came and told me this is the first time they have worked in Tamil cinema for 20 years. They're saying this is the first time I hear a female first AD handling the mic and coordinating the set. And that's just really sad. And, you know, like I didn't even have to, like, you know, I'm like, why? If you're a director, it's fine. Why is it so difficult for a first AD to set the scene, to do all of this? You know, I'm saying, if men, like, I'm a big fan of James Baldwin, the African-American writer, James Baldwin, and I love the way he handles white supremacy. And that's what I want to tell men who don't have yet the courage to deal with female narratives. I mean, just it's for your benefit that you grow up and let this happen, because then the sooner we catch up, the sooner we're going to have fun making films. You know, I want to write a brilliant, brilliant, brilliant male protagonist. I really want to have like Rajinikanth level heroic scenes for my female protagonist. Let the lines blur. All that you have to do is just accept that you're a little behind, and just catch up so that we have fun, you know. I don't know if I answered the question, but I think I said everything I had to say.
You also had us all falling off our chairs. My goodness, the questions from the audience are really like, okay, this is a question from Matt. Rima or Anjali, will you take this? I was slightly shocked and incredibly happy when I read about WCC for the first time in the newspapers. And since then, you've grown into an incredible organization which stands up for gender equality. Do you think Malayalam cinema has changed much after that? This is supposed to be a question on the content of Malayalam cinema, whether it has been impacted by the existence of WCC.
Rima, go for it. I think you can talk about the content and I will take the other side of it maybe. And on screen, off screen.
Okay, I don't know. Should we mention the Kasaba issue actually? With content. Oh my God. Okay, I don't know how many of you all know this. But then there was this one incident while we were all at IFFK and we were at a panel discussion and me, Parvati and Geetu were on stage and we were talking about misogynist content and you know how, you know, we still don't object to a certain kind of gaze and a certain kind of scenes where the hero, in order to be shown as heroic, is shown assaulting almost assaulting a fellow female actor in a movie called Kasaba. And Parvati called him, you know, this whole scene out, like, you know, how, why as an audience, like why as a society watching this movie, nobody has found it to be wrong. And the actor starring in the movie was Mammootty, one of the biggest stars in the film, Malayalam film industry. And the next day, this came on social media and it kind of just blew up. Like the whole state kind of blew up because a few women had questioned something that was so inappropriate in a film. I think we reeled under that for like a year. Or are we still there, Anjali? I think we're still there. But, you know, it's in a slightly better space. But I'm saying we are just asking a question, okay? We're just asking, don't you think this is wrong? Don't you think we should all be reacting to what's happening on screen? It's normalized to another degree. And, you know, from then on, I think the change that we have seen is maybe all scripts are, let's add a feminist dialogue here. It's in vogue to a lot of male actors, male directors having to do female-led movies. Even now, just like I think somebody was saying, a woman director taking a woman protagonist movie is two minuses put together even now. And I recently saw this group of young male directors sitting in an interview, and the interviewer actually asked why. So a particular director there had done a female oriented film, and he was asked, oh, you have done a female oriented movie, why aren't the other female directors here doing the same? Shouldn't they be taking the lead? But they don't understand the kind of, you know, the space, this industry where it is two minuses put together. You would rather, you know, take the easy way out because you want to launch your career as a director or as a producer, or you want to do something here. You know, maybe nobody thinks of the whole picture. They'll just sit and, you know, ask their aunt questions. But here, has Malayalam cinema content changed? I must say there is a lot of thought being put behind it, maybe. But it is more on the side of, let's be on the correct side of this whole conversation. Not, okay, let's just really talk about new perspectives, new narratives. You know, let's do something radically new in that space. I don't think the thought process is coming from there. Am I making sense? You know, the thought is not really to do something new there. You know, let's make this out of the world narrative with a woman, you know, lead or a woman perspective or in that space that has never been explored before in the last 100 years. I think the thought is not there. Coming from there, let's just capitalize on, you know, there's something happening here, something feminism, I think it's in vogue right now, let's just try and do. I mean, we're still there. I don't see it going beyond that at the moment. The women who really have something to say from their side are still not welcomed. We still have to fight it out there. If, you know, we need a movie greenlit. It is very, very difficult. In that sense, I really don't see much of a change. No, I don't.
Okay, Anjali, do you want to take that too?
Yes, I think I might be a little more optimistic. I think over the years, from that time till now, we've had some very interesting perspectives put out there. I think a lot of you may be familiar with a film called The Great Indian Kitchen, which, you know, actually was a fresh take, and it was not done before. And I remember at that time, when all of us were appreciating the film, people came out and said, see, a woman didn't make that film. Why didn't all these women who were talking make that film? And I was thinking, that's actually wonderful that this film is made. And I would rather celebrate the film than the gender of its maker. So that is where the problem is. So when you are, you know, a woman in this field, you're expected to shape, shift, and contort your views to fit within what is in the market. And when another sensitive person makes a film and it does well and it's received well, then that also turns against you. That, see, you guys couldn't make something like that. So
that's what.
Now, the thing is, you have to, there is a certain empowerment that also requires. There is a certain, if a woman were to go with a script like that and try and make it, I don't know how successful they would be to get to finally making it. I frankly don't know. Not to take away any credit from the maker who did it, because how such empathy, that film has been made with such sensitivity that I was so happy to see that out there. You know, that's brilliant. But this constantly having to get crucified, it's like anything that goes wrong within, you know, the area of gender, first question is, what is WCC doing about it? So it's not enough that you're already fighting the fight. It's important that you pick up everybody's litter. So I don't know how many men are actually asked, why aren't you making films about women? Why aren't they asked that? Do women not matter in their lives? So when you talk about the content of Malayalam cinema, my excitement lies in these few voices which are actually portraying women's stories and putting it out there for the general public to have a shift in their perspective. That excites me. Similarly, you take a film like Kumbhalangi Nights, to see a toxic man who's not celebrated. You know, a toxic man who we can be shocked by, who we can be appalled at, who we can laugh at. That was amazing to see. That, again, written by a gentleman. You know, so these are shifts that we're seeing. And these shifts are, for me, I sense these to be somewhere at a level which is touching the audience. People are responding to this content. That excites me. So they may not be sort of tectonic plate shifts, but they kind of, you know, there's a sprinkling of hope there. When you see a film like Maya Nadi, which is a more gender balanced love story. You know, that excites me. Whereas it's not just about women being out there playing the superhero. No, it is not that. But the regular cinema going audience, when they're able to respond to a story and see a slight difference in how genders are positioned and maybe relating much more closer to life, then that indicates that there's a difference in thought. And so for me, the Malayalam cinema is not just about the makers in the films. It's as much about the audience. So the audience, which was fine with something being a joke 10 years ago, is not laughing at that joke today. So when I see a bunch of, filmmakers who are Malayalis, who are, being questioned about what is your take on WCC. Rima, this is the same, group of gentlemen we were talking about. And they laugh at it and they say, oh yeah, we knew this question was coming and, it's wokeism, and they laugh about it. I also laugh, but unfortunately it's at them, because they're just missing the boat. So there are parts of Malayalam cinema which are changing, and we welcome that. And there are parts which are not changing, which will end up as fossils, I believe. It's just a matter of time. I think Darwin has proven it. So we shall just wait and watch.
The beauty of The Great Indian Kitchen is that a film that is in Malayalam, a film that is does not have the usual trappings of commercial cinema, a film that is it's unapologetically slamming patriarchy, was a film that was embraced to such an extent by the entire country that a global streaming major had to eat humble pie and reconsider its decision to reject it and, platform it ultimately, because the audience wanted to see this film on patriarchy. And the politics of that film was so right because, Rima, you spoke about feminism being seen as the school new thing for some people. And it's not just Malayalam cinema. And I was wondering if, Kutty Revati and Shazia would address this, because I see this across the board, but in cinema too, where there is a certain male gaze on what the cool progressive woman is. And there is therefore a certain stereotype that is coming up. She is abusive. She's constantly brusque with everyone around her. She has to be a smoker. And I'm not morally judging smokers, but it's like a woman is not cool and progressive unless the character is a smoker and she drinks a hell of a lot and she swears a hell of a lot. And I remember this filmmaker telling me that he was backing this film by a particular writer, and he said, you've got to meet her. She's so cool. She could drink any man under the table, and she's written this script. And it's like this notion of the strong woman that we're seeing, because it's the man's notion of the essentials of being a strong woman that's also emerging on screen. Am I right? Would you agree? And what can we do about it beyond speaking out about it?
I think the most important thing is people use this term strong women. And what they mean by it is their understanding of what strong women are. That basically a person, almost a superhuman, who's able to deal with anything, come whatever, or it could be somebody. And it's a stereotypical, right? It's a urban woman drinking, smoking, probably having multiple relationships. So these are stereotypes. And if it doesn't fit in that, it doesn't fit in the cool woman idea. And the problem with that is it dehumanizes women. It does not let us be flawed, it does not let us be everything that we allow men to be. And that's the problem with it. And exactly like how we deal with filmmakers, like Jenny was saying that she just wants to make a big blockbuster film and she wants to sustain for 10 years. And I want to take that further and say, I want a space for me to fail. Where is the space for women filmmakers to fail? Because the moment we talk about women, whether on screen or off screen as makers, we expect them to be perfect. We expect them to be, our understanding of complete women is a superhuman that does not really exist in reality. And that's how men write women, that they don't know women, that there are no women around them. Like, just look at your own family members, your wives and mothers and daughters, just observe them and you will understand that how women are. Like, we are human first and we share that level of being flawed and being problematic. And I mean, last year, one of the most problematic female character I thought was written by a female writer. And it was really like, I took it up on social media and then I realized it's my mistake. I'm allowing 10 other men to write problematic women. Why am I not allowing this woman to write a problematic woman character? So we need to create that space, because we have to look at women as people, and men just cannot, I mean, a lot of men just cannot look at women as people, and there is this glorification. Like, they want to treat women as Devi. The whole Madonna whore theory, right? So it's either this or it's that. We are compartmentalized by the male narrative. that it's either, you know, it's a motherly character or it's a girlfriend, it's a good girlfriend who will wear salwar kameez and you can take her to the parents, or it's a bad girlfriend who will go and socialize and drink and wear short skirt. I mean, how do you look at people like that? How do you compartmentalize people like that? And that's the problem with the male gaze. They don't look at us as complete people. And it's either strong women, weak women, they are just putting adjectives and dividing us into certain characters. And when they write male characters, male characters are also problematic, but you know, they at least understand men better. But the moment it comes to women, it's like we are aliens. It's like just there are three women in your house. Just look at them, observe them, talk to them. You are not from the gender, but talk to them. Do your research well if the understanding of a woman is inaccessible. Writing a minority character, whether it's a Muslim woman or whether it's a Dalit person, it's a LGBTQ person. The thing is, if you're not from that particular minority group, the best thing is do a lot of research to understand that character. Or else, please keep away from it, because then what happens is what we're seeing on the screen. And strong women, we need to get rid of the term strong women. We are people, we are equally flawed. Please let us have that space to be flawed and to fail and all of that, that you allow a man to be.
Yeah, you know, I said, Kuti Revati, could you take that question? But because
we actually
crossed our time, but I'm just wondering actually if I could address another question to you, which is that, even in the response to films by women, I feel like the response is different. And Shazia has touched upon that. I feel like when I listen to audiences and even film critics, there's much more of a minute scrutiny of the work of women directors or of films that are dominated by women. And there is an expectation of perfection that is not there from films that are made by men and about men. Why is this, and what can we do to combat this?
You know, I answered the second question first. The scrutiny of female creators' works, you know, aren't we doing more than the perfect, you know, what people expect, or audience expect, critics expect? I think though it is seen as female artist work, female filmmakers work, I think we go beyond their level to present us, to represent the society completely. But it would be seen, you know, even in literature, that's how it has been always. I think I have given the best, but I will be criticized all through the times, in different ways, with male perspectives, with male parameters and patriarchal parameters. It has been always like this. But, you know, we should be very tactic and strategic when we work and when we present ourselves in the cinema industry, I believe, because it's a big floor. It's not just a small person dealing with the whole industry, because you have to run a team. And I'll connect with the first question as well, because still I am not able to get rid of the tax that I have been, you know, carrying. After Mulegal poetry collection, it is like wherever I go, I would be named as a person of tiger. You know, even during the Marian sets, I was the only woman on the set, so I would be always called Black Tiger. Let this lady go away. You know, let us talk. That's how I have been called on the sets of Marian. So it is not going to be gone completely. In the cinema industry, we have just gotten hold of the medium, I believe. And everyone's story is going to be totally different from the next woman, you know, working in the industry. And as Anjali mentioned, I want to give a stress on that it is going to be different for the woman working behind this scene, working on the scene, and working as a technician. It's going to be totally different. And maybe what we can do in this kind of flows, we can be listening to each other's stories and we can get a joy about that. That's the ultimate thing, I think, because it's not going to be, we have to be a gallant person on the set. You know, you cannot be this person or that person. I have to find out, I have to explore the complete gallant energy so that I can handle the medium creatively. And maybe, you know, you may have to face the sheer arrogance of every male person, you know, when you are into making the film. It's not going to be simple. There may be, you might be hearing about popular filmmakers and who are very socially concerned. But when it comes to a male, he's just comes to you with all his arrogance only. So it's not going to be simple. But I think somewhere we have to be super intellectual. We have to be super gallant. We have to be super individualistic also. But at the same time, somewhere, you know, it is like being a team like this, you know, I can feel the sheer joy of everyone, because someone is really doing that, you know, with all the guts. And I think cinema is the medium that can offer the humankind the complete, you know, the peace, harmony, and joy. It should be taking us to a different era altogether. And it can be done only by women, only by women. So we cannot be blaming, we cannot be apologetic, we cannot be feeling small. And somewhere, as Jenny also mentioned, that it is, you know, when I am on the set, I am the super person, I am the super woman. And those are the happiest days in my life. Whenever I see Anand Cine Service van going on the road early in the morning, I would be very jealous and greedy, and to the, you know, I want to go to the shoot spot. But being a director is not very simple, you know, very easy. You have to assemble the project, and there would be expecting a man or woman collapsing it. You have to, you know, assemble it again from the beginning. It's not good. I have, you know, 10 scripts with me in different, you know, genres. You know, I can go to any producer with any kind of script. I would narrate with most powerful ways. But I am the I am with all the gallant, because it's not going to be easy, because you have read the history of women's struggles, women movements. You know the India's, the complete picture. We see every day, you know, a lover couple hanging on the trees. And India is shameless, you know, it doesn't feel any shame when it is killing or raping women. So we have to emerge out of the shit, and we have to be beautifully smiling at, you know, all these things. It's not, you know, whether I always look at actresses, and I would always say to Parvati, you know, being an actress is the most powerful form of being a woman in the country, you know, because you are physically vulnerable, you are emotionally vulnerable, but still you are able to emerge out of it and present your power on the screen. So, you know, every person, you know, in the industry, whether it's male or female, you know, it is going to be considered only the person of cinema industry. That's how we have to see it ourselves, I think. I don't see it as a woman, just a woman. As I said, I'm going to be a gallant woman. You know, I'm not concerned about the failures or successes, but we are aiming at the success, because what else I'm going to do in this world, you know, in this one life. And I felt the very emotional part of it in WCC meetings. So I gathered all my bones and fleshes there, and, you know, I'm here. Thank you so much for this opportunity.
I poured so out.
And, you know, I know the back end team is getting very tense, because we have a performance coming after this, the Tetsuo sisters, and they need me to wrap up. So I'm going to put a question. I'm going to ask you, Sunita, if you can respond to the same question, but very, very briefly. Is there a greater, more intense scrutiny of cinema by women and cinema that revolves around women? And I'm begging you just for a very short answer only, because I'm getting yelled at in my ear.
Well, I have to say yes. That's the shortest answer. it's the need of the hour. And I think the most important thing for all of us, when we call ourselves collective, when we call ourselves coming together, because we are always scrutinized for actually being historically the people that have pulled things apart, you know, I think it's the time for all of us to leave that behind and do a new narrative that we are going to hold it together. I think the time has come for us to be together and kind of tell the stories that we need to tell and work towards a very humanistic voice, because it's only the woman that gives the birth. It's only the woman that can bring the humanity together. And I think it's time for that in the storytelling.
You know, I mean, the fact that this, you know, this is such an engaging discussion, and the fact that the questions are still flowing in, and my heart is breaking because I have to say bye, but I am going to still squeeze in one more question at the risk of being yelled at further. Deepti, this last one is for you, and I don't know who the audience member is who asked it, but this is very specifically for you. Hi, Deepti, it's nice to hear your experiences working as a cinematographer, but I wonder, why are you calling the lens a weapon? And by calling it so, don't you think that you are taking a certain position, a certain specific stand at looking at things? I'm requesting you for a brief answer to the extent that it's possible.
I don't know why I called it that, but I think what I meant was you can use it to conquer something that you feel you're fighting. You know, an image making style, a certain kind of storytelling, a certain kind of depiction of women. That's what I mean. I mean, don't just use it to point at someone, something just to beautify, or, you know, to beautify and to make things poetic and philosophy. That's part of our work, you know. But what is, we need text and the subtext both, right? I guess I just meant to claim the lens, not just use it as a device. That's all I meant. Also, I'll keep it very short. There was a 23-year-old, very young female DP who called me today. And she said, I'm being asked to shoot a project for which they need a female DP. And I feel like I'm being asked to shoot it because it's they're making an exception. Like when you call for a taxi with a female driver, you need a reason to get a female DP. It's not, you don't just get a female DP because it's a normal project. And I'm enraged. And I told her, take it up. Do your best. Don't get offended. Because all we can do is, nobody can offend you till you get offended. Just do your best and excel. And the next time they won't even ask that question of so many other people. I don't know. I do think we have something to prove, all of us. That's why weapon, I guess.
You know, like I said, my heart is breaking for having to say bye to all of you, because this has been such a riveting discussion, and to have all of you powerhouses here with us, it's a moment of great pride for the Network of Women in Media India that you agreed to be over here. Thank you so much, Anjali, Deepti, Jenny, Shazia, Sunita, Rima, Kuti Revati. Your life experiences are inspiring to everyone, and I can still see questions coming in. And I think the measure of how solid a discussion has been is when the moderator and the people in the audience feel like just half an hour more is all we need to ask you more questions. We are running out of time. We have run out of time, but I'm still going to take a second more to say a thank you also to Beena Paul and Meenakshi Shede, who introduced this discussion. And to Beena and Miriam Joseph of the Women in Cinema Collective were instrumental in putting this panel discussion together. And the reason why I'm taking this time out is because sometimes there is this artificial divide created between the senior woman feminist and the younger woman feminist, as though feminism is something that each generation believes it parachuted into this world and invented and laid the ground for those coming after. But you know, irrespective of what age you are, the fact is that we stand on the shoulders of generations of women that have gone before us, and we stand on the shoulders of great women like Miriam, like Beena, like Meenakshi, like members of the Network of Women in Media India that I know I take for granted. And I'm only going to name the two members, the senior members who I interact with regularly, but there are so many more. Lakshmi Murthy, Amu Joseph, who have kicked open glass doors, that now people of my generation aren't even aware once existed, and who have crashed through glass ceilings and fought battles that we don't even realize were once fought. So thank you to everyone behind the scenes at NWMI WCC and to every one of you over here. This has been an amazing discussion. To the audience, if you missed watching the entire discussion, you can go to our YouTube channel. The Techio sisters are performing after this, and I have heard them. They are amazing. They are sublime. They are beautiful. So we will take a small break for a message, and then the Techio sisters will perform. So please stay with us. Thank you, everyone. Thank you.